Mr. Calder, Helen goes first. So this is Peksenak versus Kijakazi.
Yes, Judge, that's correct.
Okay, you can start. Go ahead.
All right, thank you. I'd like to reserve 1 minute for rebuttal.
That's
fine. If it please the court, my name is Charles Talbot. I represent Mr. Paul Peksenak. He appeals a denied Social Security disability case, both at the administrative level and by the lower court. Currently, he's 100% disabled veteran. When his insured status expired for Social Security disability insurance purposes, he was rated at 90% disabled. The first concern we have is the disregard by the agency of the decisions of the Veterans Administration related to disabled veterans. This court ruled in the McCarty case in 2002 that VA decisions were entitled to great weight, and if the judge was going to not accept a VA decision, he had to write a decision that explicitly explained why the particular ALJ was not going to give any credit to the VA disability rating. Unfortunately, that decision has been consistently rejected by the court or by the judges, as evidenced by the fact that in the numbers of years since 2002 that McCarty has been the law, in the Ninth Circuit at least, and in a number of other circuits, there's not a single ALJ that has given any credence to VA decisions. In our area, Puget Sound area, we have a very high veteran population. We have Army base, Air Force base, Navy bases, a number of VA hospitals. So we have a large veteran population, many of whom are disabled to one degree or another. In the years since McCarty, I've probably had anywhere between 50 and 75 cases where I have represented disabled veterans at 100% or 90% with a rating of unemployability. In not a single case has an ALJ given any significant credence to a VA decision.
This is Judge Smith. May I ask you this, please? I take your point about McCarty and what it says. I guess what I'm struggling with here is, in this case, the ALJ have had substantial evidence that the claimant's depression was not severe in the time period in question, whereas the VA disability rating dealt with a different period and was calculated based upon an aggregate number of things that were wrong. For example, there was a 30% knee injury, 10% tinnitus, 10% hiatal hernia, 10% arthritis of his right hip, and 10% superficial scarring. So it was not clear how that, and 70% I think was depression. So it's not clear how the VA got to the 90%, and basically the ALJ seemed to be saying that, look, you're claiming depression, you may have depression at a different time, but you don't have depression at the time we're talking about. Isn't that sufficient to respond to the McCarty requirement?
Well, I understand what you're saying, and that the depression issue is not substantial outside of the VA rating. However, this court has said in the past that depression is something that is often underreported and not stated. And I'm not suggesting that as a way of avoiding what the court said or what the judge said below. But it should have been, the other issue should have been addressed, and particularly, as you mentioned, the right knee condition, which is certainly much a greater issue over time than what's reported in the VA decision. Mr. Peksenak was injured in the course of his military duties in a training accident where an M16 bullet went into his right knee. And that's the genesis of his right knee problem. He's had more surgeries on the right knee than one can count. And he has an unloader brace on it, and that goes way back before the date last insured. And he has a cane, which is prescribed by the doctors who treat him both in the VA and outside the VA. And and this is reflected, I think, in the RFC that reduces his physical abilities to a sedentary ability to work.
Mr. Watson, look, could you just follow up a little bit more on Judge Smith's specific question? If we were to agree with you on this VA issue, what would you require the ALJ to do on remand?
Well, even if one, if you accept the notion that the depression in the VA decision doesn't seem to follow after that decision, there's other physical problems listed in the VA decision that are throughout the record. And so the VA decision can be given at least some partial credence as to those other issues. And in fact, the medical records, I think, indicate that these other conditions are worse before the date last insured, to the extent that he was unable to engage in any work activity on his own for a period of 5 years. That's reflective of the date last insured of March 31st of 2011, when his insured status ran out. He had no employment for the preceding 5 years. And that was as a result of, and I'm not saying it should be given 100% credence, but it should at least, some of those ratings should have been incorporated or considered as part of the judge's analysis. And essentially what the judge did is he rejected the VA decision in its entirety.
Well, is that because of an, if you will, apples and oranges problem? To me, and I kind of think is what the ALJ suggested or hinted at, the VA analysis of these problems, which are admittedly severe, are very different than the analysis that's done in the Social Security disability area. So you're kind of asked to compare, in the words of Justice Kagan, apples and watermelons. So exactly what is the poor ALJ supposed to do here? Taking at face value everything you say about what the VA found, it is written in an entirely different basis than what the ALJ is looking at, is it not?
Well, what I'm suggesting, and to use your apples analogy, I'm not saying accept the whole basket of apples. Just take some of the apples that are both in the military arena and the civilian arena, if I can use that analogy. You don't need to take all the apples, but you should at least take some of them.
And how does the ALJ do that? Given the way the report is phrased, how does the ALJ pick apart the VA ratings and have a comparable analysis in the normal Social Security disability area?
Well, as the this court said in McCarty, it's clear in all instances, proof or otherwise, that the two rating systems, the two disability systems, are different. But the end goal is the same, and that's what the court said in McCarty. It's the end goal is the same in both programs, regardless of the manner in which that goal is reached. So my point is that while you may not accept all of the analysis done by the VA, at least the analysis that the VA expressed in the rating decision carried forward into the medical records that preceded the date last insured and even followed the date last insured should be melded together to achieve a result that's more consistent with the claimant's physical problems.
Go ahead, finish up, and then I have a question for you.
I was just going to add that one of the problems in this case is the fact that a lot of the medical treatment that was supposed to take place with the VA got deferred for a variety of reasons.
I want to just zero in on one aspect of the record relating to the VA's treatment, and that relates to his left wrist. So am I reading the record correctly that when he was going to, as I understood, he was going to have that surgery on his wrist to fuse his left wrist?
Yes.
The VA, and then the VA canceled the surgery. Is that correct?
Yeah, the doctor that was going to do the surgery retired.
So what happened? So he was willing to go forward with this. My understanding, I was reading the record, is that the surgery was scheduled, but before the surgery, the doc retired. Is that right?
Yeah, the surgery was supposed to take place to fuse the left wrist. I want to say back in 2010, that decision was made.
Okay.
And the doctor that was to perform that wrist surgery retired, and so the surgery was canceled. And since then, he's got a wrist brace on that basically locks the left wrist in place, so it really can't be used. And to some degree, the ALJ recognized that in the RFC when he limited the left wrist or left hand use to 5 pounds maximum. And
so one of the things the ALJ said about this was that he declined to go forward with the surgery. Is that correct?
I don't think it was a decline to go through the surgery. They couldn't get somebody assigned to get it done. And one of the problems as far as the VA is concerned is there were significant issues with the VA in terms of treatment issues back in that time frame. It's gotten a lot better since because of the focus of various politicians on VA issues. But back in the day, I don't think he made a decision not to get the left wrist surgery. It was just wasn't offered by anybody at that time.
Well, the ALJ seemed to suggest that he didn't follow through on recommended treatment.
Well, I don't see. I didn't see that in the. I'm sorry, I didn't see that in the record.
Okay, all right. Let's see. I let you go over time.
All right. Thank you.
Somebody's phone is ringing.
Yeah, that's mine.
All right. Well, maybe you can turn it off for us. All right. Let's hear from the government.
Good morning. My name is Catherine Watson for the commissioner. I first want to emphasize that the relevant period for this case is only 2 months. The alleged onset date is February 1st, 2011. The date last insured is 2 months later, March 31st, 2011. The ALJ here reviewed the record, and the ALJ did find that in the years following the date last insured, the appellant's condition worsened. However, the ALJ reasonably concluded that the appellant did not show disabling limitations during the date last insured. Now, turning to the VA ratings, as Judge Smith mentioned, the ALJ here did provide persuasive reasons to discount the VA ratings. The ALJ discussed about the differences between those two programs, and while those differences in every case might not be persuasive, in this case it was. Because
Ms. Watson, did the VA discuss the relevant VA rating, or did the VA discuss, or did the ALJ discuss the 2013 rating?
The ALJ explicitly mentioned the 2013 rating. However, on the next page, I believe that's page 27, the ALJ, transcript 27, the ALJ assigned little to no weight to the VA ratings, plural, and the ALJ also cited to all of the VA ratings. So he seemed to refer to them as a group, although he only explicitly mentioned the 2013 rating. However, even if this court were to find the ALJ erred by not being more explicit in mentioning all of the ratings, including the 90% rating, which was 2 days before the date last insured, his reasoning applies with equal force to all of those ratings. Notably, the 90% rating was based primarily on depression. And here again, under Social Security standards, we cannot rely solely on subjective reports. The ALJ found not only that depression was not severe, but also that it was not even medically determinable because there was not objective evidence in the record of depression during the relevant period. There was simply some vague complaints indicating that he had some depression. I'd also like to briefly touch on the delays. Peksenak was scheduled for a surgery in December of 2010. The VA physician retired.
That's on his wrist, correct? His left wrist.
Correct, on his left wrist. The VA physician retired. They referred him out. And then during the relevant period, which I believe was in January of 2011, the appellant went to a surgeon. This is on transcript 230, where he examined his left wrist. He told him he could have left wrist surgery. However, he also indicated there was no rush for that surgery. And really, he should only go through with it if it was limiting his activities enough. In other words, if his pain or limitations were severe enough such that it was limiting his activities, then he should have the surgery. He did not at that point go through with surgery. And he did not ultimately go through with his hand surgery until a few years following the date last insured. This is consistent with the ALJ's finding that yes, in the years following the date last insured, his condition worsened. At that point, he did elect to proceed with wrist surgery. Similarly, for the knee surgery.
Hold on one second. So my understanding is that the VA said, this is the surgery you need. The left wrist fusion, it was scheduled to go, correct?
I'm not aware that the VA said this is the surgery that you need. However, he did schedule a surgery with the VA at the end of 2010.
And then but before the surgery, the doc that was going to do the surgery retired.
Yes, in the record, there's
obviously his wrist was a serious condition. Correct at that time?
Correct.
And after the surgery did not go forward because of VA situations, he consulted with a private doctor, somebody outside of VA.
Correct.
And then that doctor, as you just said, had his recommendation was you didn't really need fusion, you need something less, correct?
The doctor didn't say he should not have the fusion surgery. The doctor indicated that he could go through with the fusion surgery, but it was not necessary. In other words, he was young, he was active. If it was not limiting his activities enough, then there was no rush for him to go through with it.
I wonder if I could take you back to McCarty again. Judge Reinhart was very specific in his instruction about how the ALJ should treat the VA's determination of disability. And let me just read a couple of things and I want your response about what happened in this case. He said, an ALJ's decision, and I'm now quoting, must ordinarily give great weight to a VA determination of disability. And then he went on to say, the ALJ may give less weight to a VA disability rating if he gives persuasive, specific, valid reasons for doing so that are supported by the record. What is the commissioner's response? What's the best response to the question of whether or not the ALJ in this case complied with?
In this case, the ALJ's reasoning, which focused on the differences between the two programs, the fact that in the VA, more deference was given to subjective complaints. In the Social Security Administration, there needed to be evidence of a severe medically determinable impairment. Those differences, in many cases, may not be persuasive, specific, and valid. In this case, it was. And the reason why, in this case, those differences were particularly persuasive is because, in this case, the VA based its rating primarily on depression. an impairment that the OJ reasonably determined was not only not severe, was not medically determinable, because we don't give as much deference to subjective complaints, because we do need evidence, objective evidence, to substantiate those complaints, even just to establish an impairment. And I note that that was not contested, the fact that depression was not medically determinable during the relevant period.
Although I certainly believe these systems are different, McCarty itself indicated, and again, I'm quoting, that an ALJ's decision errs by, in quotes, distinguishing the VA's disability rating on the general ground that the VA and SSA disability inquiries are different. So even though I see the apples and oranges problem, that's not adequate under McCarty. I am troubled by the fact that if we send this back, it's not going to change the result. Very likely, but has the commissioner satisfied what McCarty requires in this case?
I would say that as a categorical, that generally in Social Security cases, we view things case by case. So while McCarty indicated that generally speaking, we should not be simply saying the programs have different standards, therefore we can reject them, and that is correct. Certainly in most cases, the mere fact that they have different standards would not be a persuasive reason. But it's our position that in this case, that particularly reasoning is persuasive, and the reason is due to the specific facts of this case. So it's our position that those rules should be looked at a case-by-case basis, and while as a general rule of thumb, I would agree that would not be sufficient reasoning, for the facts of this case, it would pass muster under McCarty because a persuasive, specific, and valid reason.
Let me ask you this. If we were to disagree with you on the VA issue, and we decided it needed to go back for further consideration, do we need to go on and reach the RFC any further part of the analysis here?
If you were to find that we erred and needed to go back for remand?
Yes.
For further
VA issue, what happens? What happens at that point on remand?
I would imagine remand would serve the purpose of the ALJ being more specific that depression was not medically determinable here, and therefore he was not giving weight to the VA ratings, which were based primarily on depression, and it would be once again affirmed if you were to send back based on that reason. It's our position that there were no harmful errors. There would be no basis for sending it back if you were to disagree and send it back in our reason. It's my guess that would be what would occur. And I'd also—
I don't know. I don't want you to try to predict what the ALJ might do. I'm concerned, and it is possible. I mean, I would like to think that it's possible that he could come out the other way.
That the ALJ, based on the VA ratings, well, I would note, it's anything is possible, but we have an uncontested finding that depression was not medically determinable. We don't have a lot of evidence, really any objective evidence of depression in the record. So it's hard for me, at least, to see a way in which we would give that 70% depression a lot of credence. What I would say for the other ratings, during the relevant period, I believe there was only one rating. I want to say it was the left knee that was 30%. The others were 10% or less. That's consistent with the RFC, which actually does amply account for his impairments. It does limit him to less than sedentary work. It accounts for his left wrist issues. So in many ways, it is consistent with those other impairments in the VA rating. And I'd also note that those other impairments did become worse, consistent with the ALJ's finding following the date last insured. In 2015, the VA found that, I believe, the knee impairment did reach 100%. So consistent with the ALJ's findings, consistent with what the VA found, the condition did worsen in the years following the date last insured. So there are consistencies there between the VA and the ALJ's finding. The main difference is on depression, which again, the ALJ here found was not medically determinable.
Okay, let's hear a rebuttal from Mr. Talbot. Mr. Talbot, are you still there?
Yes, Judge, I am, thank you.
Okay, you have a minute for rebuttal.
Thank you. The focus as far as the left wrist is concerned isn't so much whether he had the surgery or when he had the surgery. It should be a focus on the the impediments of the left wrist. And with an immobilizer brace, basically it negates any use of the left hand or wrist. And while the judge did say that 5 pounds was the maximum ability to lift, that is inconsistent with sedentary work, which requires occasional lifting and carrying up to 10 pounds. And except for one of the jobs listed in the record, they all require frequent use, or they require frequent use of the hands, which is obviously problematic if you can't even lift 5 pounds. As far as McCarty is concerned, it seems to me that the focus of the decision was not the difference in the systems by which one determines whether somebody is totally disabled or not. It's the end result which is important. And it's improper, in my opinion, to reject VA decisions simply on the grounds that the method in which the determination is made is different. That's not the point. The point should be based upon the medical evidence. And as far as the rejection of VA records, the agency has gone so far in 2017 to codify rejection of VA records. And that's in 20 CFR 404.1504. And part of that refers to decisions by other governmental agencies. And it specifically says in that section that, read it in part.
Okay, and then after this, your time, you're over your time, but finish your point and then that'll happen.
It just says that they're not going to consider decisions of other governmental agencies. So the point being is that the agency has been very resistive of McCarty and the treatment of cases requested by the court in McCarty. Thank you.
Okay. Could you give me the citation again, the CFR citation you just gave about consulting other agency records?
Yes, 20 CFR
404.150. 20 CFR what?
404.
.1504. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, counsel. We appreciate your arguments this morning. The matter is submitted at this time.
Thank you.